Divine Truth Assistance Group. Group assistance sessions putting principles of divine truth into action. This recording is from the Developing My Loving Self group and is part of an Education in Love series. In the Session 1 group feedback presentation, Jesus gives group feedback about how the awakening to sin involves the acceptance of our own facade, and that most people who listen to divine truth and then leave it and go back to their former way of life have refused to accept the facade. Recorded on the 22nd of May 2016 in Noosaville, Queensland, Australia.
The subject I'd like to talk to you about is the process of accepting your facade. And the reason why I'd like to talk to you about it is because before you even process anything like I've just discussed with you, it's highly unlikely you're going to even get to that place without accepting your facade, right? And in fact, what I have noticed is that almost every single person who's heard divine truth and left it has left it because they refuse to accept their facade. Do I need to say that again? Every person, or most people, there are some exceptions, but very few. Most people who have left divine truth after hearing it have left divine truth because they refuse to accept their facade. Interesting. Now, most of those people also get angry with God, angry with Jesus, and they usually finish up going back to a very similar life that they had before. And all because they just didn't want to accept their facade. A whole lot's just because they didn't want to accept that they actually have a facade. Now, when a person doesn't want to accept their facade and somebody comes along who is only wanting to confront the facade, and any person who lives in truth will confront your facade, any person who lives in truth will confront the facade. When somebody comes along who does confront your facade, that's the time that is the most difficult time in your progression towards God, because that is the time that you are most highly likely going to leave listening to God's truth, that time. And that's the time when you also get the most spirit influence to leave God's truth, that time. Now, I thought perhaps the best thing to do is give you some examples of how this is. There's a couple I know who I've known I met them 6 years ago. They visited my home and they wanted to know more about divine truth. They heard it somehow, I can't remember how now. And they visited my home, and that's the first time I met them, and we used to visit them frequently. We used to travel quite a distance to visit them frequently over a period of nearly 5 years. As long as I didn't confront their facade, they were thirsty for God's truth. As soon as I confronted their facade, they became angry and resentful, and I don't see them anymore. Another couple, again, we used to visit quite regularly, myself and Mary. As soon as I confronted the wife's facade, the husband supported the wife in the facade, and eventually, like, she put a lot of pressure on him to do it. It took 3 months or so, and he eventually agreed with her facade, and now they actively oppose everything I do after us being friends for a long period of time. Another guy I know, he was listening to Divine Truth for nearly a year, He asked for some feedback, some personal feedback. He was overseas. He asked for some feedback. I gave him some feedback. And from that moment on, he has set up internet websites to attack me and so forth and so forth. And that pattern has been done over and over and over and over again. Thousands of people like that. As soon as they confront their facade, that's it. That's it. And not only is that it for some of them can't even just walk away anymore. They must attack. They have to. They desire to. They are spirit influenced to and so forth. It's really, really fascinating. So, this is what I've found. Everybody likes to hear God's truth. About the universe. I've yet to meet in any discussion I have ever had with any person of any kind in any century a person who doesn't like that. Isn't that fascinating? Like, and I'm talking about people who are drugged out of their brain, drinking alcohol like fish. And, you know, I'm talking about, you know, people who are in the most difficult of places emotionally and physically. You talk about this with them and they're fascinated. I've never met a person who isn't in my whole life. The hardest criminals to the, you know, to any religious person who's open enough to have the conversation in the first place. Never met a person who isn't fascinated. But when it comes to this, I have yet to meet a person. It's not quite true. this is a big, big problem. Big problem. Big problem. It's very rare to meet a person who hasn't at some point not been angry with me for exposing something in their facade. Very rare. In fact, historically, I can only think of a few people in all of my dealings with every person who haven't at first been angry, usually with me. Interesting, huh? So what does that tell us? We're resistive to personal truth. We're resistive to personal truth. It is the thing that you is going to stop you. If you're resistive to personal truth, it is the thing that's going to stop you from engaging God's path, God's way. It is without a doubt the single thing that is going to cause you to walk away. Many of you haven't even got to the point of that decision point yet. Because you've not been had many personal interactions with me. And a lot of the personal interactions you have had with me, you've been able to avoid by going, oh, no, I don't believe that, or dismissing it, you know what I mean? But see, with these people who've spent a bit more time with me, we've got to the point where they haven't been able to do that, where they haven't been able to dismiss what I'm actually saying to them. There was another lady, overseas again, but she's a medium, she's quite involved. She wanted to do some channeling and stuff with us and everything, but we were sitting around with a group of people on a table and she made the mistake. I don't think it's a mistake, but she later has later said that she felt it is, a mistake of asking me what I felt was her condition with regard to mediumship, because she was a medium. She was a medium who sold her services to others. And we had a frank conversation. I think one person recorded it, actually. It's not a very clear recording, so you've never heard it. But from that moment on, she did everything she possibly could to oppose anything that I did in that location. Another one travelled with me for months. nearly a year. She did a whole heap of mediumship. She did a whole heap of other things, you know, quite resistive to truth during the way. But eventually it built up to such a point. We went to one location, and it was in Greece somewhere, and she started treating the host who allowed us to stay in her home for free quite badly, which I had to address with her. And she became very belligerent and spirit-influenced, and she influenced both her children, who were also travelling with her at the time, to do so. And she became so, and that was the beginning of it. And then a few weeks later, she did the same thing again. And eventually I had to say, look, you can't travel with me anymore, because she was so angry and upset. And then she decided that she was going to write to everybody she'd met on her travels with me and accuse me of a whole heap of things that I've never done, which she actually did. She wrote a 7-page letter to everybody. Right? Things were all this list of things that were not true. And sent it out to everybody. And now she opposes everything I do. Just one point of truth. Now, I've seen it happen over and over again, first century and now. I've seen it happen in the spirit world. Big problem. The thing that's going to challenge you the most on this path is God's truth about yourself. And there's going to be times when you definitely want to blame me for telling you what that is. And there's going to be times when you're going to want to oppose even what God's truth is in order to avoid what your personal truth is. Right? And the key for you is to recognize those times as a part of this terrible terror you have about deconstructing your facade. To recognize it as the problem rather than the solution. Right? Removing myself or God's truth out of your life is not a long-term solution to your growth. It's not. The long-term solution to your growth is to actually do the things necessary to have a relationship with God. And if one of those things happens to be accepting the facade, just even accepting it, not even doing anything about it, just accepting it that you have one, is going to be one of the biggest choices and decisions you're going to face in your whole life. And if you don't accept your facade, it's highly likely you will be in hell for a long time. Highly likely, when you pass. And it's highly likely you're going to have a difficult life on earth unless you spend most of the time meeting all of your addictions as possible. So what I unfortunately see people doing is they hit this facade, just one part of it, like a minor things. Like, you know, like one lady that I told you about, I just told her that her mediumship wasn't sincere. She was doing it for ulterior motives to earn money, and it was out of harmony with love. That's all I told her. Another lady, all I told her was that she was angry with me all the time and I would not spend any more time with her unless she stopped being angry with me. That's all I told her. Another guy, I told him, unless you stop attacking your ex-partner, right, there's no way that you're going to progress. That's all I told him. Another guy, I told him, he asked me, what's my condition in comparison to my wife's? Now, why would you ask such a question? I don't know. But I told him what the condition was in comparison to his wife. He wanted to know. He is so angry now. He's still angry with me. I can still feel his anger with me 7 years later. And what do you think is happening to his soul in this time? You can see it just degrades and degrades, right? And this is the problem you have, is that if you can't handle the truth about yourself, then you are going to really struggle to have a relationship with God. Right? And so what I'm suggesting to you is to develop a desire to know the truth about yourself. But even before then, you're going to have to develop an aspiration to handle it. Do you know what I mean? To cope with it, to cope with the fact that a lot of your personal motivations are not loving. Now, we've seen in the last day and a bit, we've seen the reasons for that, haven't we? The reasons why our personal motivations aren't loving. We need to have compassion for that. I have compassion for the fact that many of your desires are not loving, right? And you need to have compassion for it too. It got built by a whole series of very difficult, psychologically distressing processes that occurred right the way from the time of your conception through to now. Now, many of it also comes about from the decisions that you've made in that place as well. So it's not just parents' sin or society's sin, but also your own choices that has created this. And what I'm suggesting is we need to come face to face with that. That's a part of having an awakening to sin. Now, remember, a few months ago, it might have been last year actually, myself and Mary had a discussion, a discussion in the studio. And one of the discussions was about having this awakening to sin. I don't know if many of you watched that, but my suggestion is to have a watch of that. Without an awakening to sin, it is impossible to engage God's laws regarding redemption. Right? And therefore, it's impossible to receive divine love if you do not have an awakening to sin. And this is where you create most of your sin. This has been created by your own sin in the past and the sins of others. This is where you create all your new sin. And unless you have an awakening to sin and its cause inside of yourself, which is all about recognizing where you're at with things, unless you do that, it's going to be very, very difficult for God to expose any new thing to you, any further truth. Now, remember, the point of this series of Education in Love series of talks is to help you get this connection with God. And what I'm suggesting to you is, unless this happens, the deconstruction of these things happen, you will not be able to have a connection with God. Now, that is a huge problem if you want to grow and learn God's universal truth, because you need God to communicate with you to learn universal truth. That's what you need. That's the only way you're going to get the truth in your soul, and it's the only way you're going to be able to receive God's love as well. And you need that to actually grow and change. You need that to become the best you can be. And yet, if we shut it all down with these techniques, which are learned techniques, we shut it all down and we're unwilling to face ourselves, then that's going to be it for us. We're not going to be able to get educated by God. We're going to have to rely on education from others. And my suggestion to you is, you know, there's a lot of problems with education from anyone else other than God. A lot of problems with that. You are then dependent upon what they know, what they think they know, and all sorts of other things like that. That's what you're dependent upon after that. And your whole progression, your joy in life is going to all slow down as well as a result of not knowing truth, living in fear and so forth. You see? Now, the reason why I've raised that with you is because I know it's a very big pattern, right? Frequently, and when I say frequently, it's almost like, it'd be like 99% of the time, a person asks me for some truth. And in almost every case, that person, if they let that truth hit their heart, that person leaves divine truth, never listens to it again, and finishes up attacking me as well, if they let it touch their heart. Many of you have not let it touch your heart yet. But when you do, you're going to feel that. You're going to feel it. You will feel one comment, touch your heart, and after that, for many of you, all bets will be off after that. you won't want to do anything about that. Jen, you want to ask? If we just have my mic with...
Sorry,
it's all right. It's all right to ponder, Pamela. Get caught unawares.
You sound like you're saying it is inevitable.
It's not inevitable. I'm just saying that for 99% of the people it happens. But it's not inevitable.
Okay.
When is it not inevitable? If you're humble. That's when it's not inevitable.
Which is what I was going to ask you. Is there... It feels like you're warning us.
No, I'm just telling you a statement of fact, actually, of what's happened in the past up to this point. That's all I'm saying. I'm saying that where people get stuck is here. Here. This accepting my facade, this is where people get stuck. They don't want to accept it. They don't want to accept that they have all of these unloving desires and unloving beliefs and false beliefs, and they don't want to accept that quite frequently they're lying to themselves, lying to others, and quite often, and they don't want to accept that from God's perspective it's sin. They don't want to accept that it causes pain and suffering to themselves and to others. They don't want to accept any of those things. And so they don't accept their facade. You tell them about their facade and they don't want to hear about it. And not only do they not want to hear about it, but now they're going to kick into protection of it. The rage-based protection of it, even. So most go to this, and then a few go this way, to the anger and rage. Now I'm going to punish AJ for what he said for the rest of his life. Now, the desire to punish anyone for the rest of their life comes from very dark emotional state. And that desire means that you're going to be in the hells when you pass, without a doubt, right? So this is where we need to take a lot of care with what we do. You'd be far better off just going to your addictions without trying to cause further harm for somebody who's told you about your facade than you are to attack the person who you've asked about the truth about your facade. And it doesn't matter whether it's me or you or anybody else who's getting attacked. From God's perspective, we're all equal, right? So from God's perspective, you attack somebody and you keep attacking them and you want to pull them down for the rest of their life and the rest of yours, that requires some very dark emotions to drive. And that is going to mean that that person ends up in a very dark place when they pass. All right?
Yesterday I realised that I had had a lot of help in getting to this place.
Yes.
And it seems to me that what you're saying now is one of the most critical conversations that we could have, because in this place I've not reached, or we've not reached that critical moment that you're talking about.
Well, you're getting, this is what
still,
I'm saying, is most
still getting help here.
Yeah, but most of you are near this place. Most of you are near this place where it's touch and go. It depends on how you're going to handle the next steps you make as to what's going to happen. Right? Many before you have gone. Millions. Thousands on earth. Thousands. Hundreds of thousands. Like, hundreds of thousands of persons on this planet at this point in time have already heard divine truth. Right? The majority of them are not listening anymore. And this is the reason why.
It seems to me that it takes a lot of faith. Or
question,
a lot of,
Jen. You're off with the story.
What is the something?
No, you want me to say that it's faith now, so I can't do any more with you. Let's
okay.
go. David, thanks.
Why is it so hard for us to accept God's truth about us? Like, why have so many gone that way?
I talked to you about this in the first group, but it is because of the connection between our worth and truth. In other words, what we have inside of us is that we believe we're only worth something from God's perspective, or from a person who's sharing truth with us perspective, we're only worth something as long as we're doing the right think whatever the definition of the right thing is by that person. And we have this very strong connection between our worth and hearing the truth about ourselves. In other words, we think whenever we've heard the truth about ourselves that disagrees with our own concept of ourselves, we believe our worth is being attacked. What we believe is that we are being pulled down. We are now not being treated as equals. We are now being treated as a subservient or something like that. And we respond very angrily to any attack upon our personal value. Does that make sense? That's yes. Why. Yeah. So the main reason, like my feelings for you are, you're worth the same as me. It doesn't matter what your condition is. From God's perspective, you are worth the same as me. I'm worth the same as you, right? Now, that doesn't change the fact that you have certain facade-based addictions that I can recognize that you can't see, right? And if you ask about them and I tell you about them, if I decide to, that doesn't change the fact that I still believe you're worth the same as me. You follow? Yeah. I don't feel you're worth any less. Even though you can't see some things that I can see, I know that you will be able to see those things if you take the same path I've taken. So I know that in the end, you have the ability to see the same things I see, right? So your worth to me is identical to my worth, right? But the problem is when I speak some truth with you, you don't believe that anymore because you've got an association between the worth and your current concept of yourself. And that has to change. That has to change. Without that changing, it is highly unlikely you are going to get through this phase of accepting your facade. Highly unlikely. Yeah. Because whenever your worth is triggered as in the negative, you want to respond in this state, in rage and anger and so forth. Or just what I would call dismissal. A lot have chosen dismissal, you know, cynicism and doubt and dismissal. That's another way of handling it. Right? But either way, you will not get through this phase. This phase has to be done. You have to get to a stage of accepting your facade without judgment. And what you're doing whenever I say, you know, this is what you do to one of you, what you're doing internally is saying, you're judging yourself for having that thing now.
Yes.
Now, I don't judge you for having it. Like, honestly, you saw yesterday, I understand, and if we had some proper discussions about what we talked about yesterday, you'd see that I understand very thoroughly how all of your facade got created, far more than you can conceive at this point in time, right? Because I've seen centuries of it being created and how harsh it is towards the child, how harsh our environment on earth is towards the child. So I have complete compassion for everybody who's living in their facade. However, that doesn't change the fact that unless you get out of it, you will not have an awakening to sin. Right? And what I'm trying to do is assist you to have that awakening to sin. Right? To assist you to make these changes that need to be made. And while you associate your worth with hearing what you believe you should hear about yourself, and you are going to reject God's truth, and while you reject God's truth, you can never progress. And the danger is, while you continue to strongly, you know, attach your worth to this other thing, truth, and while you attach the two together, what's going to happen is you're going to reject truth most of the time. And eventually, the rejection of truth is going to get so intense inside of you emotionally that you'll just want to get angry about it. And, of course, the person you're probably going to get angry with me is me because I'm the one sharing it with you. But if it's not me and it happens to be your partner or your friend or your, you know, neighbour down the road, then you'll get angry with them too, right? And what I'm suggesting is we've got to disconnect ourselves. Hearing truth is far more important than sort of trying to measure your own worth while you're doing it, right? Remember, and this is what I keep saying to you, remember that God values you. God values you equally. There's no person here who is more important than any other person here. None. And that applies in the spirit world. You know, when you go to the spirit world, you'll see that there's people who have immense power. Immense power, Right? There's people who have hundreds of homes of their own. There's people who are basically leaders of cities, not just one city, but 10, 20 cities in the spirit world. And from God's perspective, they have the same worth as you. Right? Now, once you really get that and start disassociating, pulling apart this joining that you've currently got together of worth and truth, you know, you're basically saying, if I hear the truth, then it means I'm worth less. So hearing the truth equals to us worth less. Right? And it's got to change, because if it doesn't change, you're not going to get through this phase, which is this, you know, recognizing my unloving self. You're not going to accept it. You're going to judge it, condemn it, and not only are you going to judge it, condemn it, you're going to judge and condemn every single person who exposes it. Doesn't matter who, you're going to judge and condemn every person who exposes it. And it doesn't matter what you feel about me, doesn't matter what you feel about other people, doesn't matter how loving you think you are. unless you do this accepting of your facade, you are going to get angry and you are going to degrade your condition. It's a choice. Does that make sense? And all I'm doing is warning you about warning you about the choice.
It seems weird that, like, yeah, when we're confronted with truth and our worth is triggered, yet to come about that state, our worth was denigrated back down there.
Exactly. What happened in your childhood, and this is the problem, this is why we do it, what happened in our childhood was whenever anybody told us the truth, most of the time their motivation was to pull us down. Most of the time their motivation was to harm us. Right? They weren't interested in helping you. Most of the time they are interested in hurting you. Right? And that's why you now believe that anybody who tells you the truth is only interested in hurting you. Right? But it is an old belief. It's a belief of the hurt child that needs to be understood. But if you can at least understood it, no matter whenever you feel hurt from what anybody says, the key is to go back into yourself and go, okay, I feel hurt from what's being said here. It might be truth or it might not be truth. I don't know at this point, but I feel hurt. Right? Rather than acting upon my hurt and turning into rage and other emotions, I am far better off to release my hurt and then analyze what's being said. Yeah. And that's a part of accepting my facade, accepting how I really am. Right? So I get lots of comments made about me, how useless I am about this and how bad I am about that. And, you know, why hasn't he done this yet? Why has he done that yet? And all that kind of stuff. Like, honestly, if I didn't accept my facade, you know, I'd have thousands of people to be angry with. But each one of them I'm angry with would be degrading my condition. Every time I plan their destruction, it would be even worse, wouldn't it? Yeah. But go to Ben and then down the front to Barb. I had a question.
I'm just wondering that you can see things about us that we don't know.
Which you'll be able to do once you've sensitised yourself as well. Yep.
Yeah, so for me to ask you for feedback like you're talking about, is it more of value for me to do the self-discovery than just to like hook into a feedback line and go, tell me, tell me, tell me?
Yeah, yeah. When you ask me for feedback, you're placing a burden on me, a responsibility. Yeah. I haven't asked you for feedback.
Yeah, and your time and everything.
Have I ever asked you? No. Can any one of you ever remember me asking you the whole time I've known you? And yet I still believe you're my equal. So why haven't I asked you for feedback? Because I don't want to place the burden on you to tell me about what I should be able to find out for myself from God if I was open.
Yeah, just lazy.
Yeah, it's laziness a lot of the times. So that doesn't mean, though, that in a personal interaction, we have a good discussion, and we do this frequently. We've got, you know, every 2 weeks I have a meeting with Eloisa, Peter, Bruce Kelly, Corny, Lena and Igor, and we have a meeting because they've been the most open. They have a meeting, we have a discussion about different things, and during that time they get some feedback and so forth that they either choose to work on or don't. depending on what they choose to do. But I love my discussions with them and also with a few people overseas, because the reality is they're pretty open the truth, but they're not asking me for feedback all the time. We're just interacting, doing things together, creating things together that I feel and they feel need to be created if we're going to further divine truth on the planet. And as a result of those interactions, we correct certain things that need correction, including the exposure of facade. Does that make sense?
Yeah. That's what I thought. I just thought I'd check, because it's a very unusual opportunity just to have somebody that can tell you something like that. But that's what I thought, yeah.
It is, but we've got to be very careful that we don't put responsibility on that person to do it for us, because that is basically dissolving ourselves of responsibility for being a self-aware, self-responsible individual. So we want to be a self-aware, self-responsible individual, and that's going to require that we have this connection with God. And I'm doing all I can do, given my current limitations, all I can do to help you get through whatever barriers you have towards God. That's what I'm trying to do. My whole life is spent doing it. I don't do anything else.
Yeah, and I've generally found over the last couple of years that if I really want to know, it takes about 24 hours.
Yeah, usually less, yeah.
Genuine.
Very true, yeah. Very true. So, Ben, yeah, I feel the key is here. Just all I'm doing is saying to you as a group, I'm not telling you off or anything, I'm just saying to you as a group, this accepting my facade thing is the area where you're going to have the most strife. It's the area you're going to fight with the most. It's the area that you're going to be tempted to go off the beanstalk. You know, just go off, get angry, resistive, whatever. This is the area. This is the area that everybody who walks away generally walks away at this point. This is the area. And it's because we are very, very resistive to hearing personal truth. And that's because we are very, very much lacking in humility. And humility is a quality you can develop, just like any other quality. Right. Now, the reason why, yeah, it's obvious, I feel the reasons why I've raised that with you. Because I see many people continuing just to walk away from divine truth as soon as they hit this point. And it only has to be one thing, just one pet thing, you know, one thing that really hurts inside, sort of thing. And that's it. Done. They're gone. And frequently the people who are left over are the ones who are not yet sensitized themselves enough to this place. And then when they get to that place, off they go too. And then another group of people come along, and when they get to that place, off they go too. And so what we finish up with is a never-ending cycle of people who come along listening to divine truth until they get to this place, and then they're gone. And what I'm suggesting is you don't have to do that. You can get over that. You can get through that place, you know. And people offering you truth with love, because it always needs to be with love. If people are just offering you truth to attack you, denigrate you, pull you down, well, you know, I feel I wouldn't listen to it, and I don't think you should either. But when people offer you the truth with love, because they're motivated by a desire to see you have a relationship with God and see you, you know, develop the happiness that comes along from that, then if I was you, what I would do is I'd look at the motivations of the individual, rather than just running off in anger because something they said has hurt you. I would look at their underlying motivations. Are they pure? Are they more pure motivations than you've ever had at this point? And if they are, then why not listen to them? Why are we so resistive? We're resistive because we think this still. Because we think whenever we hear something true about ourselves, we think we're now worth nothing. And that's not true. You are, no matter how damaged you are the pinnacle of God's creation. No matter how damaged you are the crowning glory of His creation. The most highest laws in the universe have been created for your soul. You are a unique and special individual from God's perspective. You are equal to every one of every other of God's children, no matter what their current position in the spirit world or on earth. You have the same value to God as every one of those people. Every single one. So it's time that when we hear something about ourselves, we remind ourselves about those truths, rather than just going off on a big tangent in a spurt of addiction not getting met, you know, the rage and anger that comes from our addiction not getting met. And if you do that, you will not be part of this cycle of people who just hear divine truth for a period of time. Oftentimes it's 3, 4, 5 years. They like it until they get challenged personally. Bang, that's it. And you won't be part of that cycle. You'll continue your progress. You follow? But if you react badly to the facade being exposed, it may be many, many years. And in some of my friends in the first century case, it's been 2 millennia. And they still haven't responded after that. Yeah. When I married Mary in the first century, there was an uproar in amongst most of the disciples, most of the people who were listening. They were traumatized by the fact that their person who was their master, as they called me at the time, would marry a prostitute. And then when I let her sit in on my meetings with every person, including every male, can you imagine? Most left at that time. Most left. And many of those men who left, and many were women too, by the way, because they felt jealous and so forth, but many of those men and women who left are still in the hells today, still condemning my actions of marrying my soulmate. Interesting, huh? Just that one thing I did. I didn't even say anything to them about it. And that was it. All right. And you're going to be tempted to do the same thing. You're going to be tempted at times. Robert, thanks.
AJ, as a group who are hopefully going to develop some aspirations in the right direction,
yep.
Is there anything we can do to help each other? Because we're probably interacting more with each other than, you know what I mean? Is there one thing that we can really...
Well, I think two things. Two things, and it always gets... Well, no, I think it really gets down to the four things, doesn't it? The four tools, you know, like...
Just individually developing.
Remind each other to have faith in God's goodness. Remind each other of faith in God's goodness. When you're going through traumatic events, remind each other, God's good. We need to remember God's good. Even though bad things are happening here, a lot of that could be spirit attack and other things, or the result of our own past behavior, in fact. The law of compensation is still at work. So what we sowed years ago, it's going to catch up with us now. We can't expect that it won't, right? It's going to catch up with us. You know, my friend Luther that I raised with you just earlier, you know, he's still bearing the consequence of him introducing a teaching in the 17th century or 16th century. I forget which century now, but you know, hundreds and hundreds of years, he's still bearing the consequence of the fact that he released that he actually did that, right? So his what he sowed hasn't gone away, but he's dealt with it differently. He's faced his own facade. He's faced his own truth. He's worked through his stuff. He now has a relationship with God, right? So, but he still has to bear the consequence that he led a movement which resulted in hundreds of thousands of people, historically millions of people, historically practicing things that are out of harmony with God's truth. So that's the first thing. Have faith in God's goodness. Second thing, love truth. Share the truth with each other. Be honest with each other. Do it with love. Stop attacking each other. Be honest with each other. Stop waiting until you're so angry before you say something to somebody. You know, be brave and say the things that need to be said to your partner, to your children, to, you know, to each other when you're in your discussion. Say the things that need to be said, but be honest about it and humble about it, recognizing that you yourself have things that you've got to work through too, and recognizing that, no, you can see this problem in another, but you realize that they probably can see problems in you too. Do that. And then my suggestion is take action. Encourage each other to take action. Stop encouraging each other to go, oh, yeah, no, I agree with you. That is frightening, isn't it? And saying, yeah, I agree with you about that, as if you're saying to them, well, no, I think you're right. You shouldn't do anything, right? So stop doing that. And when they get into these rages and they're upset, where they're facing the facade and they're angry, just say, look, this is what he warned us about. You know, we're getting angry because we have facades being confronted. That's what we need to address, that. We need to feel about that. Instead of going, yeah, no, sometimes I think he's a bastard too, you know. And you know, which I often hear back people say, literally that. And you know, let yourself work through what's being happened. A lot of you think I plan your harm, you know, like you two girls who thought you were locked out of the venue today, because you arrived on time, because you believe in my badness. I'm not going to lock the room just to prevent you from getting in. If you're on time in particular, I'm definitely not going to do it. And all that had happened was that one side was locked and the other side wasn't, and they didn't realise, right? And so they felt locked out for the time. But you know, believe in people's goodness instead of their badness. Believe that, but I'm not trying to make your life more difficult. I'm trying to assist you to grow and change, you know, take action about that. And then the fourth thing, just encourage each other to feel emotion without telling stories. Now, in this group so far, you guys have been good with this. Like, I've noticed many of you, as we've been talking, you've been connecting emotionally and letting yourself feel what you feel. This is good. And you notice you didn't have to tell anybody anything. You just felt it, didn't you? Right? That's good. That's a good thing. That's what you want to do. So you know, tell each other the truth about your lives, but don't tell the story just so that you can get commiseration or approval from others. Do it so you can connect to your feelings, you know? And if you're struggling to connect to your feelings and you think you need the help to tell somebody your story so that you can connect, then go and do that. In the Robert James Lee's book, there's another example where there's a lady who, Marie, her name is helping another lady who was, it was in the section called Harvest of Jealousy, I think it's in the second book, first book. And you know, she's there. She was encouraged to tell her story to a new person, not the same person over and over again, you know, but to a new person who might benefit from hearing the story. And so Afra was a new person, so she was encouraged to tell him the story, and she had a great big fit, remember? And I talked to you about fits just earlier, and I've had plenty of them, and you're going to have some of them because there's emotions involved with all of those. She passed out, remember, on the ground. They waited for her to come around, and they picked her up and let her feel what she needed to feel as a result of telling that story. And that's the way you help each other, not by getting together and going, oh, no, yeah, your story's pretty bad, my story's bad, who's the worst story, let's do that, you know, and almost use it as an entertainment rather than actually connecting emotionally. So the other things I'll do.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah. It always gets back, these are the four tools at your disposal. And in the end, it always gets back to developing an aspiration to engage those tools. Always.
Mm. Thanks.
Yeah. Good-o. If we go to Joanne, this will have to be last one because I'm way over time. So,
In the process of facing our facade,
mm-hmm.
is it useful to look at things that you really don't like in other people?
Very useful.
And... because what I've been finding in the last few days is that I'll see something I really don't like, and when I think about it, I do that myself.
Yeah, we often see things in other people we really don't like, and And the reason why we feel so angry about it is because we're in a lot of judgment about it. And the main reason why we're in judgment about it is because we don't like those things about ourselves either.
Exactly.
Yeah. Very helpful. There's a lot of things that are really helpful. Anything that makes you angry, and I've said this to you before, anger is your guide, right? Anything that makes you angry, you know there's a problem. because it's exposing the fact that there must be a problem in this regard with an addiction not getting met. You know there's a problem, so start looking at it. You know, be honest with yourself about these things. I've had to be really honest with myself. You know, not having another person around who can tell you something about yourself accurately means that you've got to get really honest with yourself if you want to progress towards God. You've got to be really honest. And it requires self-analysis, self-awareness. And the more you develop it, the more honest you become, the more open you become to God telling you new things as well. It's just wonderful. So what I'm getting at with this discussion is that accepting your facade is, without a doubt, the area of danger. Right? It's without a doubt the highest area of danger in your progression, because it's the area where you've yet to have any real faith. Because you've yet to process through pain and suffering and feel the benefits, while at the same time getting highly influenced by spirits and other people around you to not go there because they pressurizing you to not do it. Because why? Because they created it. They're not going to want you to expose what's being created. So they're pressuring you to not do it. And then at the same time, you've got the internal pressures, your own resistance to pain and your own resistance to terror, internally pressurizing you to not accept your facade. Can you see that it's a place of, like, it's where all the pressures come together with there being no seeming positive benefit outwards? And that's why it's the period of time where most people just spit the dummy and off they go. All right. And if you can get through it, your life will be changed, you know, like forever. But what I notice is that not many people get through it. Not many people. Very, very few, in fact. On earth, very few get through it. We want to change that. We want to change that so a group of people like yourselves get through it, the next group we have gets through it. And you imagine a few hundred people getting through that phase, where they are starting to feel their terror and getting over their terror. They're not validating their fear anymore. They're not feeding their fears anymore. They start to feel their pain. You imagine the momentum of that, where you've got, and then each of you, once you've done that, you now have the ability to show someone else how to do it, because you've done it. You can't show somebody how to do something that you haven't done. And you, once you do it, you have done it, and you know you've done it, and you know you can help other people do it. And imagine if we had, 300 people helping other people do it. Can you see how the potential for growth is then? But without getting through this phase, you know what's going to happen? We're going to have a never-ending cycle of people who hear divine truth, listen to it for a period from anywhere from 1 to 5 years, and then spit the dummy and off they go and forget about it. And in most cases, badmouth it while they go. And then the next group of people come along, ignoring the bad mouthing of the previous, and they'll listen to it for a while, try to put it into practice. They get to this stage, accepting their facade. No, they don't want to do that. Spit the dummy. Off they go. Half of them bad mouth it again. And then there's a number of people who are going to have to ignore all the bad mouth, all of the anger and all of the rage. And they're going to come along, and then they'll hear about it and do it, and then get to this stage. And what are they going to do? you can see that if we're not careful here, we just have a never-ending cycle of people just hearing divine truth until they get to the point where they don't want to hear anything about themselves. Now, I grew up in a religion that proclaimed itself to be God's truth on earth. And I suppose most religions do, don't they? Otherwise, they wouldn't have adherents. You know what I've found? Is that hardly anybody in that religion is able to hear any truth about themselves. And I find that that applies to almost every religion on the planet. They're okay hearing some external, what they believe is external truth, But when it comes to anything facing internal truth, that's it. Everybody shuts down. That's our problem. That's why we can't hear God. We want to be able to hear God, because without hearing God, you're not going to get a connection with God. You're not going to be able to be educated in God's love. You're not going to be able to be educated in love at all. We need to get through this barrier, you see. Does that sound good? Yeah. So I'm saying these things to you not to, you know, make you feel down about the whole process, but rather to realize that this is the area of risk. This is where your future, when it comes to connection with God's truth and connection with God, is at risk. You either will do this and off you go, or you will do this. You will not do it. It's impossible to do anything else but one of those two things. Decision point. Jumping off the cliff point. Whatever you want to call it. It's the place where most people come to grief. Yep. And like I say, many not only come to grief in the fact that they don't face their facade and accept it, but they also now act on their facade and cause huge amounts of further damage to God's truth on earth, as well as damage to themselves. And what do you think about the laws that govern God's universe surrounding God's truth? Do you think attacking God's truth is worse or better than attacking any lie? Attacking anything at all is not good, is it? But attacking God's truth is going to have more laws that you break than anything else that you can consider doing. So it's not going to end up good if you want to do that. And this is what I'm saying to you. Nina, you would like to ask this. I've blown my time today, so it's a quick question.
We will have to face this crucial point more than once, won't we? It'll be a thing we'll need to be able to repeat.
Well, you will continue to face it until you get through this terror. Once you get through the terror, remember the goal of the facade. So this is probably what I need to remind you of. The two goals of the facade were, one, to have desensitized myself to pain, number one. Number two was to avoid terror, fear at all costs. Now, unless you get through those two emotions, there are only two emotions. One's terror and one's the desire to accept pain instead of reject pain instead of accept it. Unless you get through those two emotions, you will always be at risk, because you will have yet got through accepting your facade. Do you follow me? But the very first stage is really, so when we talk about the acceptance of the facade, this part's the deconstruction of the facade. Until you've deconstructed it, you're in danger, right? But what I'm saying is most people don't even get to the point of deconstructing their facade. They don't even get there. They don't even get even close to their fear or their false beliefs or their pain. They only get to the point where they want an addiction met, it doesn't get met, and they're angry. So they don't even accept their facade, let alone want to deconstruct it, right? And that's why I'm saying it's the point. It is the once you accept your facade, there's a high likelihood that you will proceed to want to deconstruct it. Because once you accept it without judgment, you realize all the negative things that it does to you, all the negative things it does to others, the damage it does, the sin that extra sin it creates. You realize how sleazy it is, like how, you know, it is sleazy. It's like it's a sleaze-based bartering system. Emotionally, that's what it is, and you just feel terrible with it, so you want to deconstruct it. Does that make sense? But if you don't accept it, you won't even feel that, and so you won't deconstruct it. Yeah. So I feel that once, you know, until you've deconstructed your facade, you will have danger. But the real danger is before then, is even just getting to the point of accepting it. Because most people who accept they have a facade always get to the point of wanting to deconstruct it. Most people. So that's almost like a flip side. You know how I said 99% of people who hear divine truth get to this point and split, right? Well, almost 100% of people who get to that point and accept get to the next point.
That's encouraging.
Yeah. Yeah, because it, and you can see why. Once you've accepted it and you feel the sin of it, you've had an awakening to sin now. Once you've had an awakening to sin now, you want to remove sin. You do. Once you've had the awakening, of course you're going to want to remove sin because you see all the painful effects of sin. So of course you want to remove it. Follow? So the real difficult period is this period of accepting this unloving self, accepting the facade, accepting what it generates, accepting the pain it creates, everything, without judgment. That's the real tricky part. That's the part where our worth, remember the worth, truth, equality, gets cut. We no longer see our hearing truth as a measure of our worth anymore. Right? In fact, we start seeing hearing truth is a measure that God feels we're worth something, worth enough to hear a truth, which is fantastic. So we've cut that. This is where we break that, where we break that connection.
Yeah, I find the worst truth equation really, really helpful, actually.
Yeah. So the key is, accept the facade. Once you accept it, and it's an emotional process, it's not an intellectual thing. You can't just go, oh, I've accepted it. You're going to go through some pretty hard emotions to accept it, to be frank. But once you accept it, you know, you will have confronted many of your addictions. You'll have confronted many of your belief systems already. You'll have already worked, you know, disconnected between worth and hearing truth, and that is going. And you're going to feel. You'll have the awakening to sin. You're going to feel the detrimental effects of sin, and then as a result of that, you will go, I really want to get rid of this sin now. I really want to do what I can, use God's laws that I know to help me get rid of this sin, to become perfect. Yeah. Make sense?
Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. That's good, guys. Yeah. I felt that I wanted to have that chat with you because I just see, like, for most people, divine truth is just a revolving door. You know what I mean by that? They go in, spend a, you know, few months to a year to 5 years, some of them. Some of them mean longer than 5 years. And then back out. And another group comes in, back out. Another group comes in, back out. And nobody seems to want to get, or very few get beyond. There's a few, but there's very few that get beyond this point of accepting their facade enough to the point where they really want to deconstruct it. It's such a waste of time. You would have been better off not even hearing of it, probably, right? Because you just wasted 5 years of life and nothing happened. And on top of that, you have a lot of regrets that you did it in the first place. It's pointless, you know. And because we're stuck in this area a lot of the times, we don't get to experience the joys that come from actually living God's truth. So we don't experience the joy of living the way. It's just a trauma. And after 4 or 5 years of trauma, most people go, oh, it's all too much now. I'm sick of this. I had one lady recently email me. She emailed to apologize afterwards, but there was quite a lot of... But she emailed me recently saying, you're a lousy teacher and I don't understand any. I don't know what's going on. And, you know, it's all crap anyway. And I'm never going to listen again. And she had signed it off, ex-listener, and that's it. About a week later, she emailed saying, "Well, I think I was a bit angry." Yeah, there you were. But there's going to be times in this place here. You know, that's where what's going to feel like at times. And the key is to hold on to those four tools that you have. Remember, God is good. Remember, God values you. Remember, no matter how bad you feel analysing your facade, God still sees you as having worth. Right? Remember, feelings are just feelings. They just need to be felt. They don't have to be acted on. They just need to be felt. And once you're humble to those feelings, things will change. And you've got to believe they'll change. You've got to have faith that they'll change before they'll change. But it's part of the process. Everybody has to go through it. I've had to go through it this life. Every single one of the 14 who have returned are going to have to go through the process. You're going to have to go through the process. There's nobody in history that hasn't. And the only time you won't have to, the only time somebody won't have to on earth, is once sin is removed from earth. Which may be some time yet, depending on how slow we are doing it, isn't it? Yeah. All right, well, let's have a 10-minute break. And then what we're going to do is just a summary of our last 2 days and give you some homework for the next day. So if we can come back at 20 to 4.